title like Batman versus Superman Dawn of Justice comes with a very unique set of challenges. Not only do you have an audience that is passionate and vocal about their superheroes, but in this case, the car, the Batmobile, is just as much a character as the Batman himself. And if you are the team that is tasked with building the latest version of the Batmobile, well, you better be ready to step up to the plate. We're gonna meet those guys. Guys, the Batmobile is a vehicle that has been iconic in pop culture for decades. This is a car that we've all grown up with. So when you get the call that, hey, we need you to build the newest and greatest Batmobile, how does that even begin?
Always the first thing for me is you have to sit down with the director and get a sense of what movie he's making. So I had a quick talk with Zach, and then I went out and started to do a bunch of little doodles, like this one.
So that's your first sketch.
Which I'm keeping really safely.
Yeah, I think this might be worth money one day, because it looks a lot like what I'm seeing behind me. I love that it's on a napkin.
Yeah.
Were you like in a restaurant or something?
I was at a coffee shop.
No way.
Yes. I mean, it's important to get somewhere very quickly. The director looks at this and says, you know, I get it, that's cool. And then there's a huge amount of work and people coming on board to make that car you're seeing.
And what's your task, Dennis, when he comes to you?
Basically, my task is just to make the car become a reality and not deviate from what Patrick's vision is.
So to take that sort of dream design and then to make something that's actually functional.
Absolutely, yeah. And like I said, the car warrants that effort. I really can't think of any car that's more iconic than the Batmobile.
As cool as it would be, you can't bring a napkin to the studio and say, this is what I want to build.
What do you mean? No, obviously not. It needs to start there, but then quickly you start doing some pretty serious presentation artwork.
And that's where Ed and Joe come in?
That's exactly it. I would say first, Ed worked on some early concept of the car.
Basically, my role in this was to take Patrick's original vision, the original sketch, and bring it to a realization. I think first and foremost, with any car, we established a stance, which Patrick did, you know, from day one. You can see how the rear end is way much higher than the front end, and this gives it the aggressive and intimidating first impression.
What I was able to do is extract Ed's 3D model and bring it into my software and then start checking for any problems that might occur.
With some math and some science, you could actually predict how it's going to work somewhat.
Yeah, you could do full compression on the shocks.
No way.
And then turn the wheel and recognize if there's going to be an issue with the hood.
Is there any additional pressure for you guys that, yeah, you're very capable of what you're doing technically, but this still is the Batmobile? Is that in the back of your mind?
It's very intimidating, although, you know, this is the dream project. It was, at some point it became real. I kind of like froze a little bit initially in the first few days, you know, knowing what to do. We actually took a little trip to the Warner Brothers Museum to see the other Batmobiles, just seeing how ours would differ.
If you were to ask me as a little kid, you'd be designing a Batmobile, be part of that, you know, that process, I would have thought you were nuts. I mean, that's something that you grow up dreaming about.
Dennis and Scott, so these guys give you the plans, and now you're given this roadmap where you can make the first ever performance functional Batmobile. Where do you even begin when you're given that license?
My theory behind it is if you can build a car that can withstand the Baja 1000, it's gonna survive a movie set.
If you were to modify this Batmobile, what would you have to do to make it last in the desert?
I think it's good to go. I think we need to sign up for this year's Baja 1000.
So. Let's do that.
Wouldn't that be great?
Let's do that. Let's go race the Batmobile in the Baja 1000.
It's a little wide. You might get a corner off of it.
It is a little wide, yeah. There could be some trees and stuff or some narrow spots that might get to us. But we got machine guns.
Yeah, exactly.
So we can clear those right out.
Just in case we need to blow some stuff out of the way, we can do that.
Yeah, exactly. Some of the key elements are obviously power. We want to have a bunch of horsepower. So it was about 550. Placement was a big factor with this car. Obviously, you look at the car, there's no room for an engine in the front. You can't have a motor hanging out the back, so the motor's actually behind the driver's compartment, mounted backwards.
The motor's flipped around.
Motor slipped around, exactly. We use what's basically a monster truck transfer case, a gigantic four-gear hunk of aluminum that sits right behind the passenger seat that redirects the power back to a rear end, which is another task because the ring gear has to rotate different directions. You know, so there's a lot involved in putting that thing together.
Let's talk about some of the challenges that you faced in testing by actually looking at some footage from those early goes, shall we? So where are we?
So this is Santa Anita Raceway parking lot.
And this was his first initial shakedown, you know, after construction, so.
Okay.
When the stunt guy showed up, it was really just about, you know, like it always is, making the stunt guy happy, making sure the car works for his driving style. In this case, you know, we had great guys. We had Tim Rigby, we had Mike Justice. They both have different driving styles, and it was just great to get in with those guys and say, how do you want it set up? What do you feel? What are you thinking? Just like if you were taking your race car driver to the track with your crew.
Right.
You know, you come back in, hey, give me a turn here, turn there, a little less sway bar, you know, a little adjust the tire pressures.
You got cameras all over the place. What are you looking for right here, performance-wise?
Mainly, we're just looking at how it handles, how the shocks work, how the tires react to bumps. And one of the first things that we learned watching with our suspension cam that, you know, it had some wheel hop.
How do you figure out what's causing the wheel hop?
Well, it was a combination of things. One, we had to add more valve into the shock. There is some external adjustment in the shock that we could do right there at the test session. There's basically bypass tubes where you can limit the oil flow. That helped, so we knew that we were on the right path. And then the other thing that was really fighting us was just the sheer weight of these tires. This is before we actually cut rubber off of them.
Give me some perspective, like what do these tires weigh before you cut the rubber off?
500 pounds a corner.
Yeah. 500 pounds?
Wheel and tire, yeah. Very heavy.
A tire.
And it's unsprung weight, so.
Yeah, it's massive, massive amounts. I mean, the wheels are quarter inch thick steel.
So when you cut that rubber off.
Yeah, we dropped 150 pounds or so, you know, from one of the rear tires. And that made a huge difference. Adding about 60% more valving to the shocks internally fixed the problem.
What did the day two testing consist of?
Well, this was a pretty big moment because this is the primary body piece that's basically been installed in this car. So you're starting to get a feel for what this thing's gonna look like.
That was a big moment for me.
It really was, yeah.
You kind of started feeling the scale of it.
So we had to do this test at a secret proving grounds out in the Mojave Desert. Nobody around, it was a no-fly zone. It was
no-fly zone?
Yeah.
Come on.
It was the right place. We got the wheel hop issue fixed. And that was one cool thing on this project. Everybody wanted the car to truly perform.
So now we move on to day three, and these look like full-on Batmobiles.
And this was really just such a plus for us all the way around, was to be able to have this time at the Chrysler Proving Grounds in Detroit. This is when the car really just starts looking so cool. I mean, and this is Mike Justice behind the wheel, you know, coming through cones, and this was basically mimicking roads in Detroit that we'd be filming on later. So Tim would set him up, he would time him, he'd come through those cones, and you know, obviously if he hit a cone on the Proving Grounds, he was hitting a wall somewhere downtown Detroit.
Tim Rigby, he recorded all the data. Every time we went out, he would record pressure in each airbag, tire pressure, brake system pressure, temperatures, everything. So there was a constant log.
He'd set a baseline of information, you know,
right.
So depending on what kind of circumstance they were in, he could refer back to it if he needed to.
So it was so great to have that time in the car, get Mike comfortable with the vehicle, and then once again, just make every adjustment that he wanted. And you can see a couple of those shots coming out of how the car just reacts and suspension works, and you can see him, you know, doing a little S-turn and correcting. You know, I think that's what really made the whole project such a success.
Yeah, I was gonna ask you, what was the worst thing that happened to the cars in filming?
Our biggest job on set was keeping the windshield clean and putting fuel in it.
That says a lot about this team and what you guys did.
Well, and the construction time from its inception to its finish point was, you know, staggering.
What was the start to finish from napkin to this car is good to go? How long?
I don't know, what do you think? 3 or 4 months, something like that?
So about 4 months.
But when do you ever get a chance to build something this iconic, you know, and where will this thing stand the test of time as have all the other cars, you know?
Yeah, no, it's great seeing the finished product.
Just standing in front of this thing, I feel like I'm standing in front of a sleeping monster that could come alive at any moment. It is truly impressive. It's awe-inspiring, this thing.
Everywhere you look, you know, there's like hatches and fangs that could open and close, and we came up with a bunch of ideas, which we can't reveal now because obviously they're not going to be all be in this.
This film. Is only the
but
first party.
This is exactly that.
explain sort of the thought process with the weapon system.
When we talked with Zach, he said, the machine gun, I want it to be out. He wanted to see it all the time.
I noticed this piece here sort of looks different than the rest of the car.
Zach felt very important for him to feel that this car has already been used. When the first time you establish it in the movie, he wanted to feel like, okay, went through stuff. So we talk about a plate that would have been replaced, and this is a typical.
So this is like a repair job.
Yeah, we designed the special bike, it's a repair job. And the car feels like it's been on another mission when we start the film. You see most Batmobile come out always looking
brand spanking new,
and this one you never quite see new. And I thought that was a great take from Zach.
Now this particular detail in the hood, it's a way of introducing the Batmotif without being so literal like the previous, you know, Batmobiles, and we're using like negative space to create that, inspired by American muscle cars.
Yeah.
You know, Hemi Cuda, like 66 GTO.
American muscle cars, specifically a 66 GTO, but you know. Until you said that, I didn't even see the Batman motif in there, but that's amazing. But then behind all this cool aesthetic is some pretty badass function.
Yeah, absolutely. We really wanted the car to be capable of anything that Zach would throw at it. It's basically a one-off airbag over a bypass shock system, so we can alter the ride height on the fly while the car is in motion. The car weighs 8,500 pounds. We need a tremendous braking power. Brembo was kind enough to step up and build some 8-piston calipers for us, some gigantic rotors, ton of steering angle on the thing, you know, so you can recover from any situation you might get yourself into. It has about 2 feet of front suspension travel.
2 feet of travel?
2 feet of travel, yeah. They're gigantic front A-arms. So like I said, it's all built on the same theory that you would build a race car.
That's insane. I can't wait to drive this thing. Agent called me and said, they want to know if you will drive the Batmobile. Are you okay with that? And I literally said to her, why are we having this conversation right now? Are we still talking? Of course I want to drive the Batmobile. Hey, Mike.
Hey, Sal.
How are you?
I'm good, man. How are you?
It's good. Nice to meet you. As a professional driver, as a stunt driver, you drive all different kinds of vehicles. When you come into a new vehicle to get acquainted with it, what are the things that you're looking for, that you need that seat time for?
Well, to be honest with you, usually as stunt guys or stunt drivers, we don't get hardly any seat time. But it's a big project like this with a high-end build, then we're going to get a lot of seat time. We have to, because we don't want to wreck it. We don't want to wreck a one-off vehicle and never work in the business again.
The thing that blows my mind is to think that you have this 8,500-pound car that's this wide and long that you have to pitch around like it's, you know, a 2,000-3,000-pound car.
Exactly.
What were some of those things that you started feeling that you let them know?
Well, the first thing that I noticed was I didn't have an e-brake. So they put an awesome pneumatic system in it. You hit it, it's got an air bottle, it's got clamping power, and you'll hear, and it just locks every time, very consistent.
What does your little kid Batman fan voice tell you when you're in the position where you're actually driving the Batmobile?
Sit in that bad boy and go, all right, I'm set.
I'm Batman.
And you got to change the voice too.
I'm Batman.
Yeah, natural.
No offense, Affleck, but I'm Batman.
You see these four switches here, these toggles? You know, we have big fans for cooling. You have extinguishers, 5-point harness setup. That's your gear drive. You have air ride suspension. You have a shutoff for the battery, and then we have a comms in here. You see this pedal down here?
Yeah.
You hit that pedal and you're gonna lock up, and then you can set for the corner.
Right.
You ready?
Yes.
And I'm just gonna have you come up nice and easy through the cones, make a left, circle back around to Oakley, where he'll be talking to you, and he'll set you up. Just line yourself up so you can come straight down through the cones again.
Right.
And feel it a few times, and then we'll take it from there. What's the matter?
I just can't stop smiling.
Let's do this.
All right.
Climb in, man.
Woo! This cannot be really happening.
Okay, go ahead and fire up.
Yo, check. Can you hear me? Yeah, you hear me? Yeah, I hear you loud and clear.
Copy, good check.
Action, Sal. Here he comes. Nice sound. Now just use that e-brake right as you start that turn for about a second.
Yeah, got it.
About.
You might want to try a little bit more of a rally entry.
Right.
So you'd want to hug the left-hand side of the cones, go towards the right, hit the e-brake and pitch it. You kind of want to be pitching the car drifting before you even get into the intersection.
Right.
Now you can control the rest with the throttle.
Are you kidding me?
What do you think?
It's incredible.
You like it?
Yeah.
Because you look really good. When you had that, when you stepped it out, that's where you look like you were getting in your comfort zone.
You feel good about it?
Oh, are you kidding me?
Dude, you're driving the Batmobile.
That was nice. Dude, thank you so much.
All right, well, we got to meet the guys who came up with the concept of the car, actually designed it, and then put it together. And then, of course, yours truly got to drive the thing and see that the Batmobile is no joke. Now, we're gonna meet the man who put it in motion inside the film. I feel like for all the Batmobiles in history, you've never thought about it as a performance vehicle.
When we started talking about doing the Batmobile, it was very much talking about doing, let's do a purpose-built vehicle.
I got to drive it.
Oh, you did?
I remember putting it in first gear and having to stomp on the brake just to hold on because the car is like, let's go. The first time that I actually got to set it into a drift through some cones with precision driving and then drift back around another cone, my mind was blown.
That's fun because, you know, that's the sort of fantasy of it, right? Because you want to believe that the Batmobile could do that.
Yeah, but when you're a kid and you're playing with the Batmobile, that's the kind of stuff that you're doing. You're like, and then you're jumping it and you're thinking to yourself, this is what you wish it could do. And now I'm sitting in this car and this is what it can actually do. What does that open up as a director?
By having the real Batmobile that can perform and do stuff, it's almost like when you hire an actor who can actually do martial arts. It's a character thing. It becomes a character in the movie, and I think that's what happened with the Batmobile. Because it's a character, and now it's a character that actually has skill, it changes the way you think about a badass car. We shut the streets down in Detroit, and you know we were able to do this cool chase.
We've been out here for a couple weeks now shooting a Batmobile chase. Zach and I will meet together and come up conceptually what we want to have happen. The way we approach all action is story-driven. We've had a bunch of cars crashing. We've had effects rigs flipping cars. We'll have explosions.
90% of this is practical. So this turn right here, right? I was like, Mike, you gotta let the back end go and just snap it back into the tunnel. And he was like, okay. Because we're gonna do this counter so that you can see the back end break free, right? Ooh, shoom, so you can look down the side of the car a little bit.
Yeah.
Even though it doesn't seem like a big deal, that's all concrete right there, and that's for real.
Don't hit that concrete.
Don't hit that concrete.
That's actually real concrete.
That's real concrete. And we didn't have a lot of Batmobiles. We blew this truck up for real. we blew that up for real, that's all real, that's all real, then that's a CG interior. That's a whole CG shot.
Wow.
This is a real Batmobile jumping off a little jump, but with no boat around it.
But your Batmobile actually gets to jump.
Yeah.
You feel you're building a relationship with the car every time it does something.
Yeah. See, it's cool because we never get off the car. It's like, once you're driving, you're moving. So, like, your point of view is you're with the car.
Where does the Batmobile go from here?
You know, we're coming up on Justice League, and there's going to be hopefully a place for the Batmobile again in the next movie. It does get to take its place now alongside the other Batmobiles, and I think it's a pretty high honor. It's exciting to see your Batmobile alive out in the world. It's cool.
Well, I gotta tell you, when I signed on for this job, I knew it was gonna be fun because, like all of us, little kid me loves Batman and loves the Batmobile. But to be able to see the level of detail and passion that went into making this Batmobile go to the next level, where it can perform the way it did and does the amazing things that it does in this movie, that it's actually a character that's alive, I gotta tell you, I'm pretty excited to see where the Batmobile goes from here. And I know that in these guys' hands, that can be no place but up.